Name Fenwick Shombe Musonye. I work for EPRA in the Department of Energy Efficiency, currently as the Senior Energy Efficiency Officer. Actually, what we do is to try to help the country meet its goals in the energy policy of 2018 in terms of energy efficiency, and of course to meet the SDG and to meet Vision 2030, because those are the bigger documents that we draw our activities from in terms of energy efficiency. In energy efficiency, it depends whom you ask, because I will talk about it in two levels. There's the macroeconomic level of energy efficiency and the microeconomic level of energy efficiency. When you talk of the macroeconomic level, you are just looking at the amount of energy that has been used in an economy to produce a certain amount of GDP. So we talk of units of energy per GDP that have been used in a country. So that is energy efficiency on a global scale. Then when you go to a micro scale, that's microeconomic scale, we look at energy efficiency in terms of the energy input versus the output. So you would look at two things. You are looking at energy used to produce a unit of goods, or energy used to produce certain services. But then it doesn't end there, because it's a relativist term. So when you talk of the efficiency, we have to say you are using relatively less energy to produce the same quantity and quality of goods in a given function. Let's say it's probably, it could be a supermarket, it could be a factory, it could be even in domestic applications. So that's why you see we scale it down to micro in terms of energy used. It has to be reduced, but you have to maintain the output in terms of quantity and quality. If you talk of efficiency in the country, you'll talk of efficiency in different sectors. We talk of domestic sectors, we talk of industrial sectors, we talk of commercial sectors, we will talk of vehicular efficiency in terms of transport sector. So how does the authority come in? The authority takes part of the, looks at part of the efficiency in these sectors. Generally, we will go first by efficiency in the commercial, industrial, and institutional sectors, which focus on facilities that are consuming more than 180,000 units per year. A unit is a kilowatt hour. So facilities that are consuming 180,000 units per year or above, then the authority has come in using regulations to assess them to be efficient. How? There are sets of requirements that these facilities are supposed to meet before they are considered efficient. The first one is, of course, to conduct an energy audit. But an energy audit in itself is just a document, yes, that tells you this is how you use your energy, this is what you're supposed to do to be efficient. Then, of course, after that audit, the facility is supposed now to implement the recommendations of the audit. After implementing, of course, they are now supposed to verify that they have met the recommendations. Then the other software issues in the same, that like they're supposed to have a committee, energy management committees, they're supposed to have policies. In management, you say that's software issues. Then now assist these facilities to become efficient. So that's one of the ways EPRA has been using to ensure that the country meets both micro and macroeconomic energy efficiency. And then, of course, we are talking about now appliances. You just talked about the standards and labeling, the labels you see on refrigerators. The authority saw it good that apart from these large consumers who consume the 180,000 units per year, there's also an opportunity to ensure that our people are efficient. And of course, they are also benefiting financially. So the standards and labeling came in. EPRA assisted KEBS to develop the standards. Then after developing the standards, they were rolled out using a regulation, that regulation of 2016. So now that regulation is now used to enforce the standards, where people who import the appliances, the six appliances that have been stipulated in the regulations, are supposed to seek registration with EPRA. After you register the appliances, we give them the labels. So when you walk in the supermarkets and see those labels we have there, those labels are now as a result of that. The labels act in two ways. One, of course, they show that all these products have met minimum energy performance standards that have been defined in our standards. Then two, they assist people to make choices in terms of purchase. Why a choice? It's because we're saying, well, all these appliances have met the minimum requirements, but then you can now choose from these, even from those that have met the minimum, we have the best of the best. So the labels assist the people who are purchasing the appliances to select among these five stars. If you want a two star, a three star, or a one star, then you select from there. So that also in a way helps the country to meet the energy efficiency objectives. Then I'll maybe briefly talk about, apart from, of course, because one might think EPRA only does licensing and issuing, but EPRA assists other agencies out there to meet energy efficiency goals. Especially I want to think of the county governments, where EPRA has been doing capacity building for county government officers. For the last 3 years, it's been part of our performance contract targets, where EPRA was talking to the officers in the county government to understand the concept of energy efficiency, because as you say, the concept is a bit new, so that they can also assist in the country in implementing energy efficiency activities. EPRA does process importation permits for energy efficient equipment, and actually this year we processed within 2 hours, yes, of application. So an applicant applies a permit right now, in the next 2 hours he has the permit, regardless of the day that the application has been done. So there are two ways, of course, we go to that. One, we work around the clock. So when a customer applies for the permit, wherever you are, you log into your machine, you're always checking, then we do the approvals. Then of course the emails are also open, because there are times someone might apply and you've not logged in. Of course an email will come and prompt you that a customer has applied for the permit, then this permit is approved. So we have set ourselves a service level agreement of 24 hours, but we met turnaround of 2 hours this year. Of course, we're hoping to improve on it, because you see, even as we bring these laws and regulations, we are not supposed to hinder business. So how do we do it is to make sure that we are giving efficient services to the clients, so that does not happen to maybe lower the what you call the customer delight index of our customers. They are supposed to be happy with our services, so that they also buy into the concept of regulating energy efficiency into this country. There are various pathways that the energy efficiency is going to take, of course, depending on the sector of energy efficiency. For appliances, in the next 5 years, they'll have gained traction in a way that you see right now, the idea has not diffused in the entire country on what these energy labels are. So in the next 5 years, my vision is that we're going to have the entire country understanding what labeling is, because you see customer buying is very important. They're supposed to understand what it is that they are reading on the labels. Then two, of course, we are going to have the number of labels having increased, the number of appliances. Right now we have 6 appliances. In the next 5 years, we envisage to have 15 appliances being adopted in the regulations, so that our customers or the Kenyans are going to benefit from energy efficient equipment. In terms of energy efficiency for large consumers, there are two aspects to that. The first one is, and it's my pet subject, it's about quality of energy audits. When energy efficiency comes into a country, even if you look at countries like Norway, Sweden, Finland, if you see studies that I've done before, there have been issues with the quality of audits in the first stages. That's the first 10 years. You'll find, because you see, we don't have fast is in terms of capacity building, then we do not have the issue of succession planning. So initially when Najafi started in Kenya, there were no prior experts to that. So the current pool of energy efficiency experts are going to improve with time. So in the next 5 years, we'll not have issues of quality in terms of energy efficiency. And of course, now that brings me to the second point where we will be. If the quality will have improved, which it will, of course, then we are going to have an improvement in terms of implementation of the recommendations. Because sometimes you might find auditors have recommended implementations that do not gel well with the facility because of one or two issues, mostly with the quality. So in the next 5 years, because the auditors will have improved in terms of efficiency, in terms of quality of their work, then the implementation of the recommendations will improve. Then the overall efficiency, one, the micro level efficiency and the macro level efficiency are going to improve in the next 5 years. Then of course, the other aspect of improvement in efficiency in terms of education. We did not have units teaching energy efficiency when I went to school. I remember very many years ago. Right now we have now units that are now specifically focusing on efficiency for both master students in around 3 or 4 universities, also bachelor students. So in the next 5 years, universities will have also adopted that. So they will embrace the concept of energy efficiency in terms of academia, and they are going to improve their curriculum so that they incorporate those concepts there. Then of course, you're also going to have lecturers who can teach that because of what is now going on. Students are going to be churned out who have now understood the concept of efficiency very well. GDP, if you recall, we've always talked about the Jevons paradox, where we're talking about if you're efficient in an economy, you'll find the overall or the final cost of the products and the price will go low. So the product I've been buying at 10 shillings today, if the manufacturer becomes very efficient, he may not increase the price because of inflation to 12 shillings. He might maintain the price at 10 shillings next year. So when I'm purchasing the product, I'm going to have extra money. That's the disposable income. So when the disposable income increases in our pockets because of energy efficiency, then we use the excess money to buy something else. So when you use the excess money to buy something else, you are increasing what you call the aggregate demand in an economy. When the aggregate demand in an economy increases, of course, the aggregate output is going to increase. And GDP is just about aggregate output. So the aggregate output in terms of services and goods will go up in terms of value because of the Jevon paradox, where we've had efficient production in terms of products and services, then the consumers have had excess money, which they were using to buy these expensive goods. Then this excess money will have now increased their demand in terms of consumption. So when the demand increases, then we have a good GDP.